On The Breakfast today, we take a look at how Nigerians can be part of the structuring and restructuring of the polity, despite ethnic and religious differences.
Also on The Breakfast, we will look at the prospect and shortfall of having Jose Desiro as a new permanent coach for Super Eagles.
And don't forget, we'll also be looking through today's newspapers and analyzing the biggest stories of the day. And with that, we say thank you for joining us on The Breakfast on PLUS TV Africa. It's a new day, and I am Osaogie Ogbonwa.
And I am Mercy Aboko. It's good to have you join us this beautiful Friday morning.
As always, we kick off with top trending stories and some of the, you know, stories that made the biggest conversations across the country. We're starting with, of course, a justice for Sylvester. Sylvester Oromoni, who was an 11-year-old child who reportedly was beaten to death, according to, allegations from his family and from, you know, his dying statements at Doan College here in Lagos State. Of course, as a follow-up to that, the school has been temporarily shut down and investigations have continued. But yesterday, a Nigerian, of course, he says it was a cousin to the little boy, put out a message on social media claiming that efforts to get justice for Sylvester are being frustrated or put on snail speed. Complained first of all about the suspects, you know, being granted bail while the housemasters, I believe, are still in custody. And the second autopsy report done by the Lagos State government has still not been released 2 months after his death. And of course, that created a lot of conversation. Nigerians also reacting to it, speaking about the slow pace of justice in Nigeria and why the autopsy report is being withheld by the police. Of course, there's not been any response from the Lagos State Police or Lagos State government as to why that report is being held. And, but it's basically just to remind everyone, about that case. How long it takes for certain things, to certain families and people to get justice in Nigeria. I understand there needs to be a proper investigation. There needs to, be a thorough, investigation and questioning from the suspects to the people who may have been witnesses, to his family and all of that. But it once again brings back that conversation on the slow pace of justice and if these things should take that much time. And of course, it makes you also question if there is anything that is being hidden in that autopsy report that is being withheld by the police, according to a cousin to Sylvester Oromoni.
Quite sad and unfortunate. I mean, especially at the period where there's a lot of merriment. I mean, this is a festive period, and usually you have families come together celebrating, the festivity and all of that. So I can only imagine how, the family of Sylvester Oromoni will be feeling at this point in time. The young man, he looks like a young boy who has so much prospect, very handsome young man. Probably, who knows, probably would have been maybe the president, the Senate president or what have you. But it's really, really sad. And, the issue of justice and the factor, the Nigerian factor, the powers that be might, federal might and what have you would always play. Because first of all, you remember when the story actually broke out, there were reports that those who were alleged to be have been involved in his,
in his death,
who have left the country. So you begin to ask yourself, and a lot of persons are saying that that's because you have a lot of prominent person, the elites involved. I mean, their kids are involved, and so it's a system where you can actually maneuver anything, and anything can actually work. And that's where we are at this point in time. It's really, really sad. Well, the reason that a lot of people are talking about this and are being very vocal is that it's a public case. I mean, it's a public case, and everybody wants to see. Everybody wants to hear. Same thing as the case of Nnamdi Kanu. I'm sure that you can't put that side by side, but I'm just saying that it's a public case, and I really do not know. So the major problem for us is the fact that I think that we hoard a lot of information. We live in a society, Nigeria, we hoard so much information. I mean, things that are supposed to just be very basic things, very, you know, fundamental things, we begin to make them look like they're rocket science, mission impossible, and it calls for a lot of concern. Well, all that, you know, Nigerians and a lot of persons are asking is that justice would be, you know, there should be some form of transparency. The Nigerians need to see, the family need to see the transparency in this case from start to finish. Now, you know, with that particular fact that, you know, these persons were granted bail, don't forget that the court had established that there was a case of homicide. And so it's been established that the, if you look at the what homicide and what's it called again? So there's the conspiracy, right? And so it has, there's this fact that has been established already by the court that these persons, you know, have contributed to the death of Sylvester. And I would always say that that's a plus. But what happens afterwards? What's going to happen? And we constantly would say that there's no way you're going to experience peace. There's no way a lot of people are going to recover from the trauma that they're going through if they don't see people paying. I mean, justice, it's not about you know, bringing him back to life, but the fact that let justice be done. And that's why we have the government. People would have to pay for things. I mean, that's why people are expected not to take the laws into their hands. Constantly we talk about jungle justice. Because sometimes things actually happen. And then you feel like you should take the laws into your hand. You should act. But of course you cannot act. And that's because you have a system already. That's why you have the government. And that's why you have institutions that would address all of these issues. So, but when the system, you know, begins to fail or don't live up to the expectation, then it begins to, you know, create the room for people to want to take the laws into their hands and want to act, you know, contrary to what they should do.
Well, you know, I would just simply say that, you know, the person who put out, you know, these complaints, you know, claims to be his cousin. And, you know, even if, yes, we will complain about the slow pace of justice and, you know, the seeming, you know, inconsistencies with the way that the police is also carrying out his investigation, I think, you know, it's also, you know, important that we let the Lagos State Police Command and the Lagos State Government also address some of these concerns and some of these complaints, you know, and if there are certain things that the public needs to know, then they should share. You know, I want to believe that they are carrying out a thorough investigation and, you know, some of the truth will eventually be, you know, exposed and, you know, these investigations will continue, justice will eventually prevail. That's, you know, where I want to, you know, to, you know, rest my head and expect that that would play out. If it doesn't, then of course we're going to be here to talk about it and the Lagos State public will, of course, be there to speak about these things again. But once again, rest in peace to Sylvester, little Sylvester. Besides that, we're moving on to the Minister of Information and the Minister of Information, Alhaji Lai Mohammed, who yesterday put out the achievements of President Muhammadu Buhari. Of course, they put out, I think there's 100, you know, of those achievements that went from the fight against corruption to, you know, basic infrastructure that had been built, to the economy, to the fight against insecurity and some of all of that. It's a really, really long list. Also spoke about, you know, things that the Nigerian government had purchased, you know, to aid the fight against insurgency. Spoke about how the economy had recovered in different ways. Also spoke about, you know, infrastructural investments that had been made and whatnot. And, you know, a little bit of me, you know, was wondering, you know, about certain aspects of this, but we'll let you quickly watch, you know, the Minister of Information share the list of achievements of President Muhammadu Buhari, and we'll get back to you.
In the Northeast Zone, under Operation Hiding Kai, a combination of kinetic and non-kinetic operations, coupled with a review of strategies, led to the neutralization of over 1,000 terrorists, the rescue of 2,000 civilians, and the surrender of over 22,000 terrorists, including their families. Large caches of arms and ammunition were also recovered. This is in addition to destruction of several IED bomb-making factories of the ISWAP Boko Haram terrorists. Under Operation Adarin Daji in the Northwest, the conduct of offensive clearance operations, raids, and air operations resulted in the neutralization of about 427 bandits, arrest of 257 bandits, rescue of 897 civilians, and recovery of 3,087 livestock. Non-oil sector indicated better performance of 0.79% in quarter 1 2021, 6.7% in quarter 2 2021, and 5.44% quarter 3 2021, compared to minus 1.55% in quarter 1 2020, minus 6.05% in quarter 2 2020, and minus 2.51% in quarter 3 2020. In foreign trade, Nigeria witnessed dwindling performance in 2020, arising from trade restrictions on account of COVID-19 pandemic. Disruptions of trading activities driven by the pandemic further weakened the balance of trade witnessed in quarter 4, 2019, in the subsequent quarters. Consequently, total imports in the first three quarters of 2021 rose by 57.13% from 13.97 trillion in the corresponding quarters of 2020 to 21.95 trillion. Similarly, total export grew by 40.62%, which was 13.12 trillion naira in the first three quarters of 2021, compared to 9.33 trillion in the corresponding period, an indication of improved trading activities, although with a deficit position.
And there you have it. Of course, the Minister of Information listed some of the achievements of the President Muhammadu Buhari government in the last 1 year, maybe the last couple of years. He spoke about security. I think it's the reporters online. Spoke about security, investments in infrastructure, like I said earlier, the economy, and a couple of other things, you know, that they have seen as improvements and achievements of the government. Of course, that also has created, you know, some reaction on social media with those who agree and those who do not agree. You know, and I would, you know, always say that, you know, it's fair, you know, and it's only okay, it's expected that a government would continue to pat itself on the back with the things that they believe that they've done well, you know, with, you know, they will commend themselves, they will praise themselves, they will put out their achievements, but you cannot necessarily force the people to accept those achievements. You can't force, you know, those achievements on anybody. You know, the people would have to be the judges of those achievements. It's the Nigerian people that would judge whether the economy truly is better. They will be the ones to judge whether security truly has improved and it's a lot better. They will be the ones to, you know, to judge whether the basic infrastructure that they're speaking about truly is better. And, you know, a couple of all those things. If we still are the poverty capital of the world, if we still have the highest number of out-of-school children, if we still have a lot of people who cannot afford food stuff, then...
No, but if you begin to mention all of that, you would want to agree with me that, I mean, these are some elements who are really struggling to topple, you know, the government of President Muhammadu Buhari. And these are elements, so you can't say that we're, you know, the headquarters, I mean, the world's capital of the poorest, and the poorest live in Nigeria and all of that. You can't begin to see all of that. We are, those reports are just incited by those who are not in support of this administration, and that's what it is. Yes, of course. But, you know, I like the choice of words that you use. The government would always believe, you know, they believe what they believe, and the truth is, how, because with all of this, I really don't even want to go into the details and begin to mention, oh, okay, did this happen? Did this not happen? Like you have mentioned already, policies are supposed to reflect the interest of the people. And for every time you have government policies, have that solved the problem? Does that solve the problem of the people? When you go outside on the street, what are the people saying about infrastructure? So despite all of the things that you're saying, I can't begin to argue with, you know, the Minister for Information and Culture, Lai Mohammed. But let's get to the streets. Let's talk to Nigerians. Are these things a reality? Can they feel all of these things he's talking about? When you talk about insecurity, how do the average Nigerian feel? How do we feel about security? What are the realities on ground? So there seem to be a disconnect all the time. And then I constantly ask myself, the people who rule us, do they live in space? Are they in this part of the world? You said that they're coming from another aspect of the world. So sometimes some persons would say, I think I saw a video where someone was in the FCT and then they started saying, oh, no wonder the president would never understand that, you know, roads are not, we don't have motorable roads and all of that. And that's because, you know, in the FCT, you probably will have very motorable roads and what have you. So, but like we have established, it doesn't really matter what the government is putting out to say as her achievement. I'm not even thinking that the government, it's okay to say yes, maybe out of the fact that they have to do the needful, then they begin to look at the scorecard. But which, should there be a judge in their own case? Or should they allow the people who voted for them? You know, so I'm just thinking that it's just part of the formalities, which is okay. But at the end of the day, does that really translate to the standard of living? What are the people saying? Well, are they feeling that they're secured?
Pretty much the same thing. And if there's reports that we are the world poverty capital, is there any report that counters it by the Nigerian government?
No, but the Nigerian government will constantly say that these are reports to, you know.
You don't expect the government to come out and say, oh, we have made you people so poor. You don't expect the government to come out and say our government has failed.
But even if you don't say that you have made the people so poor, you don't have to accept. But you probably have to just pay attention. I mean, it's not every other time that you feel like. I would always say that Nigeria does not revolve around, you know, Minister for Information and Culture, nor the president. I mean, Nigeria is bigger than, you know, individuals and interests. It's not always about a political party or an interest. So because every other time you have reports coming through, somebody would just decide to make it about themselves. Oh, this is about the president. Some people don't love this administration and they want to topple the government. And it's because some people do not love the face of, you know, the minister, but which is not the case.
It's really just, you know, not being able to accept criticism and do better. That's really what it is. And if you never get to a point where you can be criticized and you accept that, you know, yes, this person has a point and so you would improve, then you would never really improve. If you continue to give yourself a pat on the back, you'll never really improve. But once again, you know, like we both said, it's left for the Nigerian people to judge some of these achievements, you know, with, you know, every, you know, direction. And I'm sure that our guest on Off the Press, hopefully this comes up on Off the Press this morning, so our guest can also share his thoughts with regards to the achievements of President Muhammadu Buhari. Our final top trending story this morning goes to a young man named Ibitoye Michael Olajide, who has built himself a sports car here in Nigeria. I hope that we can quickly share pictures of that very fantastic Lamborghini, Ferrari, McLaren, Mercedes. I don't know what brand of car this is, but you know,
Ibito's, you know, Lamborghini.
Ibito's.
Yes.
Well, we don't need to call it Lamborghini. It could be anything.
It could be Ibito's, yeah, whatever.
It looks like a mixture of everything. But, you know, congratulations to him. And of course, I think he also deserves some commendation. And the things that we spoke about yesterday about how there's a lot of talent in Nigeria, you know, you would expect, you know, that we should be that country that should be able to create and build, you know, vehicles and many, many other things, you know, here in Nigeria, sort of importing all the time. But we haven't gotten there. And so when people like this take it upon themselves to still, you know, in the face of the hunger and the face of the challenges that they, you know, that they deal with every day, still go ahead and create and put themselves to work and express, you know, put out the talents that they have inside of them, it's something that should be, you know, applauded. You know, so that is him. His name, once again, Ibitoye Michael Olajide. And we say congratulations to him. And we hope that he continues to, you know, share that talent with the rest of the world. And eventually, maybe he finds himself in a place where it is truly and completely appreciated.
Well, the truth is that, you know, somewhere outside of this country, I'm sure that the company, maybe in the Western world, will soon identify him and he will be taken away.
Funny enough,
as usual,
because
that's what happened.
He could also work with the likes of Innocent and you know, other.
No, but the point is, will we even see that? That's always it. I mean, I can't even remember the young. This year, we also had, there was a report of a young man who was also involved in, you know, that craft and all of that. And he was spotted. And before you know, he was moved to one of those countries. They identified him and
Finland,
they took him out. Yeah, Finland. Right. So the point is, somebody is going to come somewhere. I mean, if they've already not started negotiations, I mean, thank God to, you know, all thanks to the internet and to social media where you can actually put a stuff now. And so some company somewhere outside of Nigeria, the Western world, would definitely come through for Ibito in no time. So fingers crossed in 2022, because we would not see it, including the ones that we have here would not pay attention to it. I mean, that's the reason why we constantly want to go out to go get coaches outside of Nigeria. We constantly think that we need to get stuff outside of Nigeria, you know, to sort ourselves.
All right, we'll take a short break, and when we come back, we're moving to Off the Press, where we have a review of the major stories making headlines across Nigeria this morning. Stay with us.